No, very good. Yeah, I have had the good fortune to knowing Elliott for more than 30 years. Well, it's getting close to 40 years even. And I must say the most amazing thing is that he hasn't changed a bit all this time. He's a really a natural wonder. And it's not only his physical strength. He has been on the past days. We have many times run up and down the Strudelhofstiege, and that doesn't mean any effort for him. And also his mind is as sharp as ever, and that is even more valuable and remarkable. Anyway, he doesn't really need much introduction here. There are, of course, young people here who may be not so familiar with his work. I would like to say so quite generally that he is one of the most influential personalities in physics and mathematics, in particular mathematical physics, of the past 60 years, and with an incredible output of important papers full of ideas. You can read more about his vita and references to his achievements on the AC homepage on the occasion of his award for the AC medal. You can see a list of his many, many other awards and recognition he obtained. Well, it's not a secret, and many of you will know that he turned 90 this last summer, and there was a conference in at Harvard University, and really a full week was devoted just to the work of Elliott. And so this is has been a great privilege to know him personally, and he has also been such an important person here for the physics and mathematics in Austria, and this institute in particular, which he has was actually, one can say, one of the founding fathers of the institute. He was then the late Walter Tiring, of course, was a very important figure in founding this institute, and Elliott was from the very outset on the International Scientific Advisory Board, and for many years he served on that. Anyway, and he has been a regular visitor here for a long time, but now because of the pandemic, he was not able to come for a while, so the pleasure is really all hours that you are here, Elliott, and we look very much forward to your talk. Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you very, very much for that very nice introduction. Can you hear me in the back? Is this thing working? Not good, huh? I don't know what to do. Better? No. Hello, can you hear me better? Better? Perfect? So it's perfect in the middle.
Now it should work.
Is it working all right?
No, but now you turned off the...
That needs to wake up the...
In the old days it was easy. You didn't have all this electronic stuff. You just got up and talked. Well, thank you very much for that very nice introduction, and I'm very pleased to be here again after several years hiatus. It was always a joy to come here and see how the AZ was improving and getting broader and so many people. It's just wonderful. This is now one of the, it's been for some time, one of the great centers for mathematical physics and mathematics and physics in the world, and very well known. And it's a real achievement, I would say. And so I've been asked to talk about some of my work. I hope this won't bore you too much. It's a little bit technical, but well, it is what it is. This is a joint work with Eric Carlin. Is this thing? Oh, does this do anything? There's no pointer, or there is? I'm pointing, but I don't see any. Oh, it's the other end? Wait a minute. Ah, now it's on.
Here's the pointer, and then the warp is.
Yeah, I know that. Okay, so that's good. All right. So Eric Carlin and Marcus Holtzman and Ian Yauslid. So it's been a great collaboration, and it's still going on. And here are two references to the work that I'm talking about. They're 0.58 centuries apart. The beginning was in 1963. And when I made this, the next paper in the series is 21, that's 0.58 centuries. But it's still going on. There are many more papers. I just did not want to write them all down. If you want to know, I will tell you privately. And it's about the Bose gas. And the Bose gas is a topic that arose in the early days of quantum mechanics. It's sort of amazing that if you look at the first few years of quantum mechanics, so many things that we accept nowadays were developed within the last two or three years. Foundation of quantum mechanics. So it was a rapid development. And one of them was the idea of Bose statistics and family statistics and the quantum many-body problem. And Bose statistics was supposed to arise in connection with radiation, but in fact it is also relevant in connection with particles in a gas, and that is what this talk is about. At first, it seemed that it would not be so very easy to measure anything about such a gas, at least to measure the Bose statistics effects. But in fact, this was achieved by experimental physicists. Some of the basic problems remain, however, mathematically, and that's what I would like to talk about. So here goes. So here I have some definitions, which most people, in fact, almost everybody here, I guess, is familiar with, but let me just spell this out to be absolutely 100% clear. You have ordinary quantum mechanics. Let's see. Yeah, there we go. Ordinary quantum mechanics. It starts with a Hamiltonian, which is an operator on L2 of some appropriate dimensional space. In this case, it's R3 n times, or R3n. And it has a kinetic energy and a potential energy, as Schrödinger told us we're supposed to look at. But it's got all these subscripts floating around. That just means that there are many particles instead of just one particle. There are n of them. And so they're n Laplacians. I'm taking the mass equals 1 and Planck's constant equals 1 and the speed of light equals 1 and all those, the charge of the electron is 1 and 4 pi is also 1 in these units. And so that's the kinetic energy term, the Laplacian and n variables. And there's a potential energy term. There are n times n minus 1 over 2 pairs of particles. And so the potential is just the sum of terms of two-body interactions. with some potential as yet unspecified. And that's it. And you imagine these n particles are sitting in a box. And the number of particles that we've got, n, is proportional to the size of the box. So the ratio of n to the volume of the box is called the density. So it's the number of particles per unit volume. That's a quantity that will be relevant here. And what the first thing we want to find out is the ground state energy, that is to say, the lowest eigenvalue of this operator. Whoops, there we go again. The lowest eigenvalue of this operator on L2 of R3n in the box. And some people take Dirichlet boundary conditions, and some people take Neumann boundary conditions, and some people take periodic boundary conditions. I'm going to take periodic boundary conditions just because I was brought up that way. No good reason. Now, the first thing we notice about this operator is that the lowest eigenvalue belongs to an eigenfunction that is positive, or has one sign, let's put it that way. There are no nodes in this eigenfunction. Why is that? It's because it's a Perron-Frobenius argument, namely, if you took any function that was supposed to be the lowest eigenfunction, then you would take its absolute value, which is a positive function, and you would observe that it's the expectation value of H in that function is the same as the expectation value in the absolute value of the function. The two are equal, but the absolute value, which is a positive function, is not an eigenfunction, therefore it couldn't have been the absolute value of a function with nodes. Anyway, so the lowest eigenfunction is a positive function. Now that's true if I don't worry about Fermi statistics or anything like that. In fact, it's false for Fermi statistics because such a function has to have signs in it because it changes sign whenever I change the position of two particles. But now we're talking about bosons, and bosons are symmetric under exchange of particles instead of anti-symmetric. So the positivity of the eigenfunction, the absolute eigenfunction, is the same as the absolutely lowest eigenfunction is the bosonic function because it's positive and unique. Now, we also assume that this potential that we're talking about is positive in X space, radial and integrable, and in fact, I'm also going to assume that its Fourier transform is positive, just to make my life easy. Now there's this, oh nuts. Where are we? Yeah. So the limiting case is the hardcore potential. All right, now we got it. The limiting case is the hardcore potential V, which is infinity if two particles are within a distance a of each other. Otherwise, it's zero. That's the case that people usually looked at, but didn't really manage to deal with properly. Well, I'm going to assume that the potential is more reasonable than that. It's in fact integrable, and to make my life simple. All right. Now the historical problem is to find this lowest eigenvalue, which ought to be proportional to the number of particles n. If there's any justice in the world, and it is proportional to n. So in other words, it's a function, it's n times, the ground state energy is n times a function of the density. Can't be anything else. And usually in quantum mechanics, one takes the square of the wave function, psi, to measure things in. Measure most or all observables. Well, I'm going to take the function itself as the relevant function to look at, not the square, the function. I'm going to assume that psi, which is positive, is going to act like a density, a probability density for me. The probability density is not psi squared, it's psi. Now I can do that, why? Because psi is a positive function. I can't do this for fermions, but I can do it for bosons. So I'm going to say, I'm going to normalize everything so that the integral of psi is 1. And the correlation functions, which normally would be what you get by integrating all but a finite number of variables, will be the integral of psi, not psi squared. So g, the density g1, for example, will be the probability of finding a particle at x1. And g2 for two variables would be the probability of finding x1 and x2 at two points. And you integrate over all the other variables. So just think of psi as a probability density. Now, those people who know about Wiener integrals, or Feynman integrals, if you like, that's very natural. Because when you deal with Feynman integrals, that's exactly what you do. You start with particles in some location and let them evolve in time and look at them at a later time, but you're looking at psi then, not psi squared. That's what I'm doing here. So it's not so radical as all that. Okay. And to normalize things, I will multiply by appropriate powers. Oh, nuts. And you don't have a mouse with separate things, do you? No, you don't. Okay. Manage with that. So I multiply by lambda so that the integrals are all 1. And because I've normalized psi that its total integral is 1. And by translation invariance, g0 will just be 1. G1, which is the probability of finding a single particle, is of course a constant by translation invariance, which I achieve by using periodic boundary conditions. But otherwise, the next interesting function to look at is G2, which by translation invariance is a function of only of x1 minus x2, and so forth and so on. And what we want to find out is the lowest energy, of course, and let me, with that purpose in mind, define little e, which is the big E, the ground state energy, divided by n, and that's the guy I'm looking for. Yes? I can't hear you.
You really mean the absolute value?
Yes, it is a function of x1, because that's a very good question. There's a whole literature that goes along, which I didn't mention, that goes along with the existence of the thermodynamic limit. And the thermodynamic limit, which is what happens when you take an infinitely big box and infinitely many particles, and you look at any two particles in this gas, it is rotation invariant if the potential, the two-body potential, is. So I'm sweeping something under the rug. But you know me, I'm always doing that, right? We're just going to assume it's rotation invariant. Your point is very well taken. If it's a small box, it would not be rotation invariant. Okay. Now, so the problem is to try to solve, find the lowest eigenvalue, and that's what I will do. Okay. Now, What was understood was the that the lowest eigenvalue for very low density gas, when the number of particles divided by the volume is a very small number, that the lowest eigenvalue will be proportional to n, as I already said, and proportional to the density, the energy per particle, I mean, and what else? Some constant having the dimension of a length. And what else could that number be but the scattering length of the potential? What is the scattering length? Well, if I take this two-body potential and I scatter one particle off the other one, there's a certain amount of scattering that I get because of the potential, and that is quantized by a number called the scattering length. I will not try to define it, but it's a property of this two-body potential, which is a given number. If the potential is the hardcore potential, then that number A is the radius of the potential. So it's like a radius, but it isn't exactly the radius of anything. All right. So what people understood was that the lowest eigenvalue for a dilute gas is proportional to n times the radius times a length, the scattering length, characteristic of this potential. Now, as you increase the density a little bit, it starts bringing in other terms. But the first term was understood for many years, again, shortly after the development of quantum mechanics. It didn't take long for people to figure this out. But it hadn't been proved for a long time. That the first proof of this fact, that the energy is proportional to the radius times the length, and that length is the scattering length of the potential, that simple fact, naive fact, wasn't proved until 1996 by Professor Ingvarsson and myself. And it was something that had occupied me for a very, very long time, and Jakob as well. And it's not easy to prove. Nowadays, of course, there have been many developments since, but until actually proving something is easy now, but hard then. But anyway, back to the early 60s. Remember, I said 1963 was the first date that I mentioned. That was the date when I said, well, in order to arrive at this fact without a proof, but arrive at it anyway, the way a physicist does, is to use the psi itself as the relevant density, not psi squared. And that's when this whole idea, which I'm about to present to you, starts to take shape in 1963. And I developed what I call the simplified approach, which was different from what anybody else was doing. The only other way, quick way, to get this n rho a term as the leading term was due to Yang, C.N. Yang, was it Lee and Yang? I don't remember. Anyway, it was Yang. And using what is called the pseudo potential, in which you replace the potential by a delta function. And you replace the delta, use the delta function to just take expectation values in the state that you would have if there were no potential at all. This trick of using a pseudo potential goes back to the early days of nuclear physics, when people were trying to understand the collisions of nuclei with each other for various uses, which became important in World War II. And that idea, it was a good idea, but goes without proof, and it's hard to use it to go beyond anything except the first order term. So I was not happy with that derivation, shall we say, and tried to develop my own, which is what I'm telling you about here, back in 1963. But the next 63 turned out to be the only the beginning of a chapter, which I'm trying to describe. All right. So what do I propose doing with this? Well, the first thing you notice, if you take the Schrodinger equation, let me go back to the Schrodinger equation. You take H acting on psi, and that's supposed to be E psi. That's what Schrodinger told us to do. So what I can do with this equation is just integrate both sides. Psi, not psi squared. And on the right-hand side where I have E psi, I just get E, because the integral of psi is 1. On the left side, I get the integral of the Laplacian psi, one term, but that's 0, because the integral of the Laplacian of anything is 0. The second term, V, I get V psi, integral of V psi. So E equals integral of V psi. But what part of psi? Well, it's G2, because V only involves two variables. So it's going to be the integral of G2 times psi. Now remember, I'm taking the liberty of saying, thank you, that G2 is a function of X1 minus X2 only, to simplify my life. So what I get then is that E is equal to, let me read this equation at the top, E is N, so I divided by rho here, N times the integral of G2 times N times, integral of GV over the volume of the box. That's the first equation I get by integrating both sides of Schrodinger's equation. Okay, that's nice. So G, remember, stands for the G, the distribution of the marginal of the two variable function. I'm calling it G of X, but it's really a function of X1 minus X2. I hope that's okay. Okay, so now let me worry about the other terms. Okay, a lot of other terms. Remember, that's one side of the equation. When I get integrate, but now let me look at this more carefully without integrating. What do I get? Well, I have all the other, excuse me, I no, that's right. So let me look at the two-body, what I get by integrating over all but two variables. I get minus Laplacian 1 plus Laplacian 2, that's still left, times this g equals eg. And if I integrated that, I would get this equation. But I keep all the other terms. I get g term from g3 and a term from g4. That is, I want to get an equation for this g, which I'm writing as g, the two-body correlation function of x1 and x2, which I'm writing here as x1 comma x2, but it's really a function of x1 minus x2. Anyway, that g is the same as that g. But there's all this other stuff coming from g3 and coming from g4. Oh, nuts. You get
the volume, the total volume of all the volumes.
Yes.
Equation. Whole fraction of volume occupied by the
Well, it'll be one asymptotically, and then when x1 is close to x2, it'll be different from one, otherwise it's one. But that's what it's the equation. You get exactly this. Which term do you object to? Remember, I'm going to integrate over all but two variables. And I have its G3 and a G4. What else should I get? What else do you want me to get? What's missing? Or I want you to be happy. Okay, so I integrate over all but two variables, but I see that there's, what do I get? I get G2 times V2, V of 2, that stays the same because it's the other variables are integrated out. But then when I integrate over X3 up to Xn, I pick up a term involving G3 and a G4, and that's the end of it. The G3 term comes when I have one is here and two is interacting with three. And the G4 term comes when one and two are interacting with three and four. So a two, four, and a one, three interaction. That's standard. It's okay? Good. Okay. So it's just like classical statistical mechanics. Much easier this way than usual quantum mechanics, where you use psi instead of psi squared. Really helps. Okay, now G, the integral of G by definition is, what is it? It's one, if I did things correctly, but I can write it as one minus U. The definition. So we know asymptotically it's going to be one, right? By the way I cook things up, because the whole integral of G has to be n, has to be the volume. So it's one minus a little bit left over, tiny little bit. And that U is going to be play an important role when U x is close to zero, that is when the two particles are close together. Otherwise, it's like one over the volume. That's how big it is. It's just enough to compensate for the missing piece. Sorry. Yeah. You'll accept it after a while, I'm sure. Okay. All right. So. All right, this is an old problem in statistical mechanics going back to the dark ages. All right, it's very similar, except that there's some Laplacians in there. Okay, now we're going to make some assumptions about how G3 and G4 are related to G2. That's what I've got to do something with these terms in order to get a full equation for G2. Because once I have G2, I can integrate it against V and get T2E over rho. And that will, good. Okay, so what I'm going to do is the simplest of all possible things. As we say, a no-brainer. I'm going to write, I'm going to assume that G3 I can write as 1 minus U of 1, 2 times 1 minus U of 1, 3 times 1 minus U of 2, 3. This is, remember, G itself is 1 minus U. Remember, x here stands for x1 minus x2. Well, now I'm just going to just repeat that. It's the simplest thing I can do. to make out of G, which is a function of X1 minus X2. I'm writing it as X here. Just make it the same for all possibilities. Why not? That's an assumption you would make in classical statistical mechanics if you were trying to find... This thing is embarrassing. Is this the only mouse you have? It's impossible almost to press the light button without at the same time pressing the forward button, because one is under the other.
One hand to as a pointer, and in the other hand you use it
okay.
for...
Very good. Oh, that's very good. Thank
maybe
you.
Try that.
Okay. All right. good. So that's what I do. I plug it all in. I get a whole bunch of stuff. Plug it in here and plug it in there. And what comes out? That's my ansatz for what I need to know about G3 and G4 in order to evaluate those two integrals. So here we go. Now, there's also order 1 over lambda corrections when I do that. And that, most of the time, they're not important. But there's one point where 1 over lambda corrections come in the G4. Always a problem. Is because it gets multiplied by n terms. So so taking all that into account, I end up with the following equation. Now that's the pointer. That on the right-hand side now is two terms. It's G itself times K minus L. K is this integral involving G with itself. It's like a convolution. Here's G with itself, the U with the G, and the U with itself, and this kind of thing. It's what you don't bother reading that slide. That's not, but you have an idea that something like this will happen. And this equation that I have now for G, inside these various integrals on the right-hand side, is an equation for G, which when solved will give me the energy. A mess. But it's a very nonlinear equation for G. G, G, G all over the place. This is an equation for G, this two-body G. And I call this equation the big simple equation because it's got everything. Anyway, later on, here we come to half a century later. This is back in 1963. But half a century later, when I made contact with Eric Carlin and Holtzman and Ian Yauslin, that one could actually try to solve this equation on a computer. It was not possible back then. You can do it now. It's a mess, but you can do it. Anyway, what I did back in 1963 was to just take the most important terms here and utilize them, the terms that would be important at low density. I was only interested in low density. Why was I only interested in low density? Because that's what people had been looking at to get the ground state energy of the low density gas. Nobody thought about doing the ground state energy of the high density gas because it seemed impossible and anyway useless. Nobody talked about the high-density Bose gas. But you'll see that, in fact, you can say some things about the high-density Bose gas, and they're interesting. And I will show you, on the basis of numerical data, that this equation that we finally end up with, in fact, works very well compared to Monte Carlo calculations. Now, Monte Carlo calculations are the benchmark for many body quantum mechanics and or many body statistical mechanics, except it takes so long to do a Monte Carlo calculation. It's not easy to do. You have to, it's not simple. So we could only do a certain number of Monte Carlo calculations and compare them with this, what this equation I'm about to show you does, which is much easier to solve than the Monte Carlo. And the two agree like a hand in a glove. Okay. So throwing away terms that are probably unimportant at small density, we end up with the small simple equation. Oh, this one does not move. This one moves. Yeah. Oh, that's a good idea. Oh, that's a wonderful idea. Okay, move. Yeah, very fine. Okay. You're great. Okay, thanks. Okay, so this is what you end up with. And I get to control the pointer. Okay, very good. So you end up with, remember, 1 minus u is what g is. And the condition is that the condition on the energy, which I showed was the integral of vg, is the integral of v times 1 minus u, of course, because g is 1 minus u. And then taking those main terms, which I didn't specify, but here they are, I end up with the following equation. This is a small, simple equation, right? Should be good at low density. You get minus Laplacian plus 4e plus v on u. That looks just like the Schrodinger equation, right? And if you stop there, that's the Schrodinger equation. Actually it was v times 1 minus u. That's why there's a vu on one side and a v on the other side. But then the new thing is u star u, the convolution of u with itself. That's the new thing that comes in when you go through all this machinery. And you throw away the terms that don't look very useful. And these are the supplementary conditions that u should go to 0 at infinity because it should... And v, integral v times 1 minus u is the thing I'm looking for, which is 2e over rho. So I'd like to know that this is very nonlinear equation for u and u star u, a funny equation, it has a solution and that it's unique. That's what I'd like to know. And if there is, then I've got my whatever it is I've got. And the claim is, there's a unique solution that satisfies these conditions. This equation and these conditions, that's it. That's a proof. That's a theorem. I will not go through the theorem, the proof of the theorem, but it's a genuine theorem. It's a very nonlinear equation. And the parity is very strange. Here you have a linear term, and here you have a quadratic. You might expect a cubic here, but you don't. You have a quadratic. If you differentiate a cubic, you get a quadratic, but you should start with an even term, in which case you'd expect to find a cubic here, but you don't. It's not like phi to the fourth theory. It's u star u over here. Now, if you haven't played with such equations, you don't appreciate what I'm saying, but the parity is a problem. And can you solve this equation? And what I did back in 1963 was solve it when the density rho, see rho appears here as a parameter, and E appears as a parameter in this equation. What we're trying to find is E as a function of rho. As we try to solve this equation for two parameters, E and rho, then set 2E over rho equal V times 1 minus U, and hope that all that works together. If it does, you have E as a, rho is a function of E. Not E is a function of rho, but rho is a function of E. Anyway, that's what you get. So now I'm going to move. Thank you. We'll go again. I'll come back to this. Move again. Move again. Okay. Existence and uniqueness. And how do we, I'm going to run out of time, so let me just say the following, that I take U0, I'm going to do this by iteration. Solve the equation by iteration. This is all very rigorous. Hitting the wrong thing. So I define U0 as the solution to this equation. Remember, what I have on the right-hand side is a V. I just take the first term from the right-hand side and hit it with the inverse of the left-hand side, and that gives me U0. That's the step number one. Then I define UN plus one by applying all this stuff to the right-hand side from the previous iteration. And we define rho n in the nth iteration as the integral of v against un. That's what I need to do the next iteration. Now, you might have done something a little bit different. You might have defined rho n. This defines rho n, you see. I might have defined rho n by the integral of un. It's another possibility. That doesn't work. But this method works. I take the solution to the nth iterate, that gives me a new density, and then I iterate. That iteration works miraculously, and it also works monotonically. As un plus one is bigger than un, and so you're guaranteed to have a limit, and you do. So, and uniqueness can be done. I will not go into that. Okay, let's move on. All right. Later on, I'll show you a graph of how this solution that I get checks against Monte Carlo. Now, what this procedure gives us is determines rho. E determines rho in this setup. Not rho determines E. That's what we'd like to see. So we're in the following strange situation. For each energy, there's a unique rho. But we don't know that for each rho, there's a unique E. That is to say, rigorously, we don't know. In fact, we do know because it's very clear from the computer calculation. So it's a true statement, but it's not true in the mathematical sense. Now, what one would like to know, and we don't know how to prove that, maybe somebody here knows how to prove it, is thermodynamic stability. We would like to know that for each rho, there's a unique E. That's number one. And we would like some convexity. You have a gas. Pressure of the gas must be positive. If it's not positive, you have instability, the thing implodes. So we would like to know this, that rho is somehow a convex function of E, or E is a convex function of rho. And what more precisely is that the function rho E of rho must be convex in rho. E of rho should be monotone and unique, like this, but it's also should be convex as a function of rho in the sense that rho times E of rho must be convex. We don't know how to prove that, but it must be true because if it isn't true, you don't have thermodynamic stability. If you built such a gas where rho times E of rho is not convex, the gas goes like that, which is not what you want. You want positive pressure. Okay. Now, what we'd like to do, so this is true. We don't know how to do is solve this big equation, which is the original thing that I wrote down before. What I had done before was pick out the salient parts of K and L and played with those, but I'd like to be able to solve the big equation. A lot of terms in there, which I'm forgetting about. And that you can do on a computer. We can do it now, a half a century later. 58 years ago, we could not do that on a computer. And now you can. Computers have changed. Are you going? Next one, sorry. Okay, so let me show you some numerical results. Let's see how I'm doing. This is what you get for this potential, e to the minus x. That's a nice potential. It's a positive type and positive. And the scattering length, which we obtained by just solving the scattering equations, is 1.25. And this is what we get. And the convexity is very clear. We don't know how to prove it, but it comes out very clearly that way. Now let's go on one more. Now, what happens if I take this in detail? And this is the first interesting graph I would like you to read. If you don't remember anything about this talk, remember the graph. What does the graph say? It says, I'm letting the density go from 10 to the minus 6, which sounds very small, but it's not so small in three dimensions, actually. Because if you want a reasonable distance between the particles, that gives you a very low density. The higher dimension you go, the smaller the density becomes. Anyway, this is a low, very low density. The green curve, the dotted curve. Let me start with the dotted curve. You see this dotted curve here, this one. This is what you get if you use what was the famous theory of Bogoliubov. And that goes back to 1947. Bogoliubov, for those who don't know, was a great mathematical physicist, one of the really great people in this field, and wrote his theory of the Bose gas, which is what every physicist uses who wants to dabble in this theory. And it's good at low density, very low density. Bogoliubov's result, this dotted curve, it's not exactly Bogoliubov, but it's very close to what Bogoliubov would give you, which is very bad for intermediate densities. It just goes off the chart. Back here, the Li and Yang, who went to the next order term, Li, Wang, and Yang, also followed Bogoliubov and got the first two terms right. And that simple equation that I showed you with the U star U, the simplest equation, gives the first two terms exactly. Let me repeat that. That equation, which came out of nowhere, can be solved perturbatively for small rho. If you solve it perturbatively for small rho, you find that the first term in the energy versus the density is the energy is rho times the scattering length. Okay, but you also get the second term correctly. How do I know I get the second term correctly? Because Li, Wang, and Yang told us what the second term in the expansion should be using the pseudo-potential. That second, I don't know if I should have mentioned it somewhere, but it's only very recently that Jan-Philipp Solove and Fournet managed to prove that the second term is correct. It's a great achievement. Well, anyway, this equation, this small, simple equation gives the second term exactly right. Not just the first term, but the second as well. So everything agrees for very tiny density. But then look what happens. As you go up in density, there are three curves, a blue, a green, and a yellow. This was the small equation I told you about. This is the big equation that I started with. And this is somewhere halfway in between. I call the medium equation. I haven't told you what it is, but there are three. This is Monte Carlo, the little x's. So this is Monte Carlo. And this is the solution of the big equation, which is done on a computer, which is possible with modern computers. You can do it. And it's spot on. This is kind of amazing. Totally unexpected. I mean, it's not supposed to be anything except in the, maybe this small end, or maybe the big end, because in the big end, you have mean field theory. When the density is really high, every particle is sitting on top of every other particle. It's very high density. And so the system again becomes simple. So you might expect that things would be accurate at very low density and accurate at very high density. But what's interesting is that it's accurate at middle densities from that one equation. Here it is. Okay, next one, please. Now, about the analytic solution for small rho, I said you could solve it analytically to get the first two terms. You replace, you can find by Fourier analysis, you find that this is the Fourier transform of U. If you make some approximations, you take that and you plug it in and you look at the first two terms, and you end up finally with this, which was the thing, so to speak, predicted by Bogle-Yuboff in 1947, proved by Fournet and Solovay about 2 years ago now, and which comes out of this simple equation. It really comes out without any fudging, without use of pseudo potential or anything like that. It comes out. And you can also do two dimensions. I was talking about three dimensions up to now, but you can also do two dimensions. And two dimensions, the formula is quite different. I'm not going to go into this. It was discovered by Schick, and some physicist named Schick, who obtained the answer in two dimensions, that the energy for low density should be rho, not rho A, but rho, divided by the logarithm of rho A squared. That's what Schick said for low density. And that comes out also. okay, and Jakob Igerson and I managed to prove this rigorously, that this really is the correct thing. And the Schick was absolutely correct. Okay, let's go on. Now, I'm running out of time, but I want to say this. What about the condensate fraction? Remember, the theory goes, or the story goes, that if you have bosons, and at zero temperature, when you're in the ground state, everything should be condensed into the ground state. Everything is K equals zero. That is, Fourier modes disappear except for the zero mode. That is, the psi should be a constant function. Everything should be constant when you have very, very, very low density, except for occasional bumps, but you don't see them at low enough density. And now, of course, that can't really be 100% true when you have an interaction, when you have a potential. You expect then that a fraction of the particles will be in this K equals zero mode. Some non-zero fraction, not the 100%, but some fraction will be in the K equals zero mode, and the others will be excited. That's what you would expect. And indeed, that's what comes out. How do you use this method to find the fraction of particles in the K equals zero mode? How do you look at the energy and decide how many particles are in K equals zero? Well, what you do, the trick is to do the following. You add, let's see where, I've lost the place here. You add to the Hamiltonian, you add the projector onto K equals zero, a little bit of it. Where is it? Pi. The projector of psi onto the zero mode. The zero mode is the constant. So you're really taking the inner product of psi with the constant function when you do this. And you add this projector onto the Hamiltonian times a constant C. Then you solve for the energy using that previous method. Then you take the derivative with respect to C at the after you've done all of that, derivative of the energy with respect to C, and set C equals zero. That will be the expectation value of this thing. That's called Feynman-Hellman or something like that. Anyway, that's a way to get to add a term to the Hamiltonian, solve the new problem, take the derivative with respect to this addition, and then set the addition equal to zero. That will give you the expected number of particles at k equals zero. So we did that. We added something to the Hamiltonian and recalculated everything with this little constant in there and then set the constant equal to zero. So let me plot not the number condensed, but the number not condensed. I mean, it's easier to see it this way, the number not condensed. And here it is. I would like you to look at this graph. If there's anything you're going to remember, it's this graph. Again, here's the density. See? Density. 10 to the minus 6 up to 10 to the 2. I am plotting for you the amount of the number of particles or fraction of particles that are not condensed in k equals zero in the ground state. For very low density, that's almost zero. There, almost everybody is in condensed into k equals zero. 100% Bose condensation when you're down at zero density. Then there's a little bit of stuff saying that some, not a little bit of certain number of particles which are not condensed. And now we see Bose condensation. This is the number not condensed. And you see the following very remarkable thing, which as far as I know, I hope somebody, or if I'm wrong, I hope somebody will tell me what is right. But as far as I know, nobody has examined the condensate fraction in any theory when you're not at either very small or very high density. And you find this very remarkable fact. And this is, these are the Monte Carlo calculations, those little X's. So that's presumably the truth. And you find that our big equation now is much better than the small equation. The small equation is not so good. But the big equation follows the X's. And it says in the middle densities, you have a lot of particles who are not condensed. And then they condense again as you raise the density still further. So this is not going back to 1963. This is only possible with a computer. So something is happening at intermediate densities for the Bose gas. There's a large number of, I mean, this number is not very big, I agree. I will agree with you, say, so what? It's tiny, but still, it's very noticeable. There's a question. Speak up. Yes, it's the same as the previous one. Everything is the same. It's just changing the density, that's all. But we did it for several different potentials, not only that one. We did it for several. They all look like this. And so at very low density or very high density, almost everybody's condensed, as you would expect. Because at high density, the interaction disappears, so to speak. Everybody's on top of everybody else, so you don't see the interaction anymore at high density. Sort of disappears, as you would expect. But at intermediate density, you start seeing things. And this, I would suggest, is something that it would be good if one could do experimentally. But we don't know how to reach such middle densities experimentally for Bose gases in their ground state, it's, as far as I know. But the agreement, mathematical agreement, between the Monte Carlo and this theory is phenomenal. So if somebody knows anything about the Bose gas and why this should happen, it was unpredicted, as far as I know. Maybe somebody knows something else, please tell me. But I don't want to call it a phase transition or anything like that. That's too glorious. But something is happening. It's clear. Okay, now let's go. Now let's look at the. I'm now essentially done. Is it okay if I go over 5 minutes? Okay. So let me look at the two particle correlation function, this G function. And again, you see here, again, comparison with Monte Carlo. Here's the big equation is this orange curve, yellow curve, I mean, sorry. And quantum Monte Carlo and the little X's, here are the little X's. They really trace that curve. This is the two particle function, this G that we're talking about, as a function of X1, function of X, the distance between two particles, is a function of X. It's got a little bump in it at this density, not at all density. Lower densities, it does not have a bump. But in the intermediate densities, which we are now at this density, it does have a bump. That's the region where you see all that non-condensation. And that little bump tracks very nicely against quantum Monte Carlo, which is, it is what it is. Okay, I think that we're at the end. I think I run out of time, huh? Okay, so here's a summary. So I would call this a theoretical physics approach to this ground state problem. That is, large fraction of computers, a bit of theory, even a theorem, but by and large, it's the computer that allows us to really tell what's going on. The approach is unusual even by theoretical physics standards, but produces exceptionally good agreement with quantum Monte Carlo calculations for the energy, for the condensate fraction, the pair correlation functions, and many other things which I am not showing you, other things that we can do. Now, on the pure mathematical physics level, we need to justify this product ansatz for G3 or G4. Remember, it's a product, 1 minus U times 1 minus U. Times 1 minus U, that's product ansatz. I don't know how to prove it. The path to proving that it's a good approximation, it seems to me, would lie by looking at in the direction of the Feynman cuts, the Feynman integrals, because there you naturally see what's happening. The Feynman integral approach, which Feynman liked so much, of course, says you start with the configuration of the particles at time zero, you let them evolve, but not with imaginary time. So it's e to the ht, not e to the iht. And look at what happens at very large time. What happens at very, very large time is the ground state, the probability density at very, very large. So that's probably the way to go, but it's very difficult mathematically. So it hasn't been done. But maybe this is a way to justify that product ansatz. Of special interest is the fact that the approach reveals properties at intermediate densities, new properties, I should say. Some new physics is revealed. I don't know what is going on there, but it's, as far as I know, it's not predicted by anybody. I hope some people might get interested in this. And I think that's the last one. I think there's nothing more. Give it a try. Yes. Okay.